Good afternoon. The COVID crisis in aged care is under the spotlight in the nation's capital, with the minister responsible under fire for comments about the climbing death toll. Our political reporter Jonathan Kersley has the latest from Canberra. Jono, good afternoon. There are calls for Richard Colbeck to be sacked.
Again, Davina, 711 people with COVID in aged care homes have died this year. That's more than last year or the year before, and we are only in February. Richard Colbeck, the aged care services minister, is facing a parliamentary hearing and a grilling today over what's been labelled a crisis in the system. He's defended previously saying there is not a crisis, claiming he wanted to be careful about his language. Today's hearing was told a third of the 2,900 homes across the country, that's around about 900 or so, are affected by COVID outbreaks. There have been staff shortages in the sector and defence personnel have been brought in to assist. There's also been claims some residents have been locked in their rooms as COVID outbreaks sweep through their homes. Today, the minister was shown images of inadequate meals he said left him horrified. And there are reports one home has threatened staff with legal action if they talk to the media. And with the number of people in the aged care system dying increasing, the minister was asked why he shouldn't be sacked or resign.
Senator, I don't accept that deaths in the community or deaths in aged care is an indicator. So I reject your assertion in the context of that completely. And it's a nice political point for you to try and make.
I think that's disgraceful. Deaths in aged care are probably the most important marker we have of how aged care is faring. We've just been through the biggest crisis in aged care ever experienced in this country, and the minister could have prevented that and didn't. He has to go.
Davina, last month Minister Colbeck was defending himself being at the cricket rather than attending a public inquiry into COVID issues within the aged care system. Scott Morrison says he has made it clear that his minister shouldn't have been watching sport, but as recently as yesterday said Richard Colbeck will keep his job. The Prime Minister says while more than 700 people with COVID have died in aged care this year, total deaths across the sector have so far topped 5,700.
It's an awful number. OK, Jono, thank you. US President Joe Biden has sent a strong message to Russia as mixed signals spark fears of an invasion being imminent. Here's CNN reporter Cole Higgins.
President Joe Biden sending a message to Russian President Vladimir Putin.
The United States and NATO are not a threat to Russia.
And a warning.
If Russia proceeds, we will rally the world to oppose its aggression. The United States and our allies and partners around the world are ready to impose powerful sanctions.
This as the Eastern European nation has amassed more than 130,000 troops near Ukraine's border in recent weeks, according to U.S. estimates.
This is about more than just Russia and Ukraine. It's about standing for what we believe in, for the future we want for our world.
Signs of a potential start to de-escalation Tuesday. Russia announcing some of its troops will return to base after completing recent drills. The U.S. and its allies are working to confirm those claims.
Our analysts indicate that they remain very much in a threatening position.
President Biden pressing for a diplomatic solution.
We're willing to make practical, result-oriented steps that can advance our common security. We will not sacrifice basic principles, though.
Startling new statistics have given us a better insight today about the country's COVID death toll. Chris O'Keefe has the details. Chris, it's interesting data. Take us through what it shows.
Well, what's interesting about it is we know that the vulnerable are the most susceptible to dying from COVID or getting some serious disease, but we didn't know how susceptible. 91%, this is from the Bureau of Statistics, 91% of everybody who's recorded as dying from COVID-19 in Australia also had other medical conditions listed on their death certificate. Now, some of the conditions are simple things like cardiac conditions, dementia, diabetes, respiratory issues. That's asthma. A lot of people have asthma, hypertension, cancer, and kidney disease. Now, these are the conditions that basically what happens is you're vulnerable because you're sick already, you've got all these underlying conditions, you catch COVID and it sets off a chain of events and a chain of reactions in your body. And unfortunately for in excess of 2,600 people that the ABS looked at, that was the overwhelming statistic. All of them, 91% of them, did have medical conditions themselves. But here was something else that was really, really interesting. more immigrants, recent migrants to Australia, have died from COVID in Australia than people who were born here. Now, some of the countries, 907 people born in Australia have been killed by COVID in this country. 1,640 recent migrants are born overseas. 732 were from Southern and Eastern Europe, 288 from North Africa and the Middle East, and 220 from Northern Europe and the United Kingdom. So that just goes to show this big multiculturalism push that they tried, the governments, federal and state, tried to get across, just simply did not work. And we have seen, I think, roughly the average age of a COVID victim in Australia was about 84 years old.
They're statistics, but they're also loved ones, and that's what we've got to remember at the heart of all this. In terms of hospital admissions, we are seeing that number and that statistic fall. Could that lead to some changes, potentially masks, indoors, QR check-ins?
It sounds like it. I spoke to a couple of people in government today, and they were saying that while we saw a spike today in excess of 10,000, we haven't been over 10,000 in New South Wales for a while, we saw the spike, but the cases in hospital are dropping dramatically, and that's good news. That's giving the government a little bit more confidence that QR codes, mandatory QR codes, not many people are using them anyway, so mandatory QR codes will be scrapped, and potentially masks in classrooms and masks in offices, masks in public spaces like supermarkets, public transport, etc. I was told that is likely to remain in place for the time being, because Dominic Perrottet and the New South Wales government, they were burned pretty badly on December 15 when they decided to make that change. But a couple of the other ones, February 28, I'm told that's when the changes will be made.
Wait and see what happens. Chris, thank you. We've been vivid starved, I should say, for the past 2 years, but that is about to change. The light program that has brought a riot of colour to Sydney will return from Friday, May 27. And in a festival first, the light walk will stretch 8 kilometres all the way from Sydney Opera House to Central Station. It's complete with 47 installations and projections. One of the highlights will be from artist Ken Doan, who'll collaborate with projection specialists to strut his stuff on Customs House. Joining us to discuss the vivid comeback is Ahsan Vezadeh from the Committee of Sydney. Ahsan, thanks so much for your time. It's a huge announcement today. After 2 years of COVID cancellations, just what does it mean for the city and for businesses that have been hit so hard?
Davina, it's so exciting. After 2 years having Vivid back, it's just so incredibly exciting for so many families and businesses around the CBD. It's been incredibly tough going for a lot of those businesses. But, you know, Sydneysiders have shown over the summer break that if there's something on, they'll come out. We've got a beautiful harbour, a beautiful clean city, just ready to be enjoyed. Unfortunately, at the moment, there's not a whole lot happening at the city. If you go in, some restaurants are operating under fewer hours, some shop fronts are kind of wound back a little bit. Having Vivid on will just spur on that business activity, will get people out there excited again about the city. And I think what we're going to see is people are going to vote with their feet and show that perhaps they've shed those kind of COVID caution and they're out there to enjoy their city again.
I guess what's really good about this as well is that we'll have international visitors here as well.
Yeah, Davina, Sydney just hasn't been the same place without international visitors, international students as well. You know, that colour and movement that we'd like to see in our city, we just haven't seen over the last couple of years. Having that rev up again, having those people come out, support our local business, and also just us being able to connect with them and hearing as well that the cruise industry is going to hopefully kick back up again, the city is going to come alive over the coming months, and it's so incredibly exciting to be in Sydney at the moment.
The other great news today, grants for small businesses that have suffered a downturn over summer. We've been waiting a long time for this. They're now eligible for government support payments of up to $5,000 a week. How will that help in general and in the lead up to Vivid?
Yeah, that's right. These grants, Davina, will really help with the cash flow that's been kind of missing from a lot of these businesses to keep them going until we see those customers back. It's great news now that the state government is saying those grants will be within those accounts very, very quickly. That's the kind of hope that some of these businesses need until we have those events on, such as Vivid, to kind of just keep operating and keep being in business so that when the customers come back again, hopefully we'll see that recovery.
Part of me is really worried, though, Sam, when you look at, we're putting a lot of money on Vivid, hoping that it works because you need that one big event that pulls everyone back. But it'll be on during the colder months. Are you concerned? Are you holding your breath or just crossing your fingers?
Look, I think the fundamentals are strong. I think people, we've just recently done a poll with Ipsos and we found that people are really optimistic about the future. Only 20% of people were downbeat about things over the next 12 months. The thing about Vivid and events like that, it's not only just about one big event. there are all these important parts of the jigsaw puzzle that will catalyze each other. You know, you'll have Vivid, then you'll have some performers possibly thinking, you know what, it might be actually feasible for me to have a show. Promoters will might think, you know what, government is actually putting this on, so we might not get more restrictions and lockdowns. It's that kind of boost to confidence that these events will really bring about for the city, each one adding to each other, that will end up, regardless of the weather, adding to more confidence and more people in the city.
Absolutely. Positive thinking. Asan, thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.